For 150 years after its founding, the US placed few restrictions on European immigration. While there were periodic outbursts of anti-immigrant sentiment, for the most part, this open immigration policy persisted up to the 1920s. In 1921, however, Congress passed the Emergency Quota Act, which marked an unprecedented shift in US immigration policy. While the country had absorbed roughly 800,000 European immigrants per year in the early 1910s, annual quotas were now set at just 360,000. Subsequent legislation placed even further restrictions, and the quota was lowered to 150,000 in 1929, where it remained largely unchanged for the next several decades. As a result, the foreign-born share of the population fell from 14% in 1920 to just 5% by 1970. What was the economic impact of these restrictions? Observers at the time disagreed on the potential effects. While some argued that restricting the availability of immigrant labor would increase labor demand and wages for US-born workers, others disagreed and argued that low-skilled immigrants were not direct substitutes for the higher-skilled US-born workforce. This paper helps inform that debate by tracing out the effects of the 1920s border closure. What happened in local labor markets that were particularly affected by the immigration quotas? To answer this question, the authors utilize the fact that quotas were assigned to countries of origin using a particular formula. In 1921, entry slots were set to be 3% of the foreign-born stock from each nationality living in the US as of 1910. As a result, immigration from Southern and Eastern Europe was severely restricted, as the immigrant stock from those countries in 1910 was small relative to their 1921 flows. In contrast, the quotas assigned to Northern and Western Europe were relatively generous, and immigration from the Americas, including Canada and Mexico, was entirely exempt from the legislation. This figure shows the differential impact across origin countries. While high-restriction countries accounted for around 70% of total immigration flows before the new policy, this number fell to 15% in the subsequent period. The authors used these differences to measure local exposure to the quotas within the US. Because immigrants tended to settle in areas with already established communities from their home countries, for example, Italians tended to immigrate to areas with already existing Italian communities, local labor markets who happened to have large immigrant communities from high-restriction countries were more exposed to the quotas. Thus, the authors measure exposure within the US by combining data on local population shares in 1900 with data on the intensity of the quota restriction for each country of origin. This figure shows how the resulting measure varies across the US after controlling for both regional factors and each market's baseline foreign-born population share. There is substantial variation in exposure even within the same state, and the authors estimate the causal effect of the quotas by comparing more exposed versus less exposed markets, both before and after the border closures. First, labor markets with more exposure did see declines in the foreign-born population. A 1 percentage point difference in quota exposure is associated with a 1 percentage point decline in the foreign-born share. At the same time, however, earnings for US-born workers in these markets decreased after the border closure. This is puzzling, as we would expect that, all else equal, restricting local labor supply should place upward pressure on wages. However, the results suggest that these markets adjusted along several dimensions that prevented this from happening. In urban areas, the decline in immigrant entry from Europe was countered almost entirely by increased in-migration of US-born workers and immigrants from unrestricted countries such as Canada and Mexico. Moreover, these new entrants were higher skilled on average than the immigrants they were replacing, and were therefore closer substitutes for the existing US-born workforce. Together, these dynamics help explain why the earnings of existing residents in these markets fell following the new restrictions. In rural areas, the picture looks slightly different. Here, wages also fell following the border closure, but this was not driven by a countervailing in-migration of high-skilled labor. Instead, the loss of immigrant workers encouraged landowners to invest more heavily in farm capital and to shift away from labor-intensive crops. This, in turn, discouraged US-born immigrants from moving to these areas. And so, while policymakers intended the immigration restrictions to benefit native-born workers, earnings for this group actually fell in labor markets exposed to the quotas. While the restrictions did open up employment opportunities for some US-born workers, in particular for those who moved to urban areas to take jobs previously held by European immigrants, the policy's overall effectiveness was blunted by the economy's adjustment toward other substitutes, namely increased immigration from unrestricted countries and a shift toward more capital-intensive production. What lessons does this episode hold for contemporary immigration policy? The authors argue that while the available margins of adjustment may differ in today's economy, including, for example, increased automation or offshoring, the effects of the 1920s border closure suggest that similar large-scale restrictions to immigration may be ineffective in generating large gains for US-born workers. To read more on this topic, you can check out the full paper and its references to other related research. These include other papers studying the effects of the 1920s border closure on outcomes ranging from patenting and innovation to anti-immigrant sentiment and mortality, research on the economics of the age of mass migration from Europe, and finally, a broader set of questions on labor market adjustments to immigration.